Tonight, on a special 2-hour 2020. The man who remade the worlds of music and dance. Michael Jackson's universal fame as he blazed into musical history. Tonight, the artists who followed his lead to become the breakout stars of their generations. The barriers he broke with every note he sang. Every step he danced. And the culture he changed forever. Michael Jackson, the man and his music. Here's Elizabeth Vargas.
Good evening. In shock, the world continues to mourn and say goodbye to the king of pop, Michael Jackson. Tonight, our celebration of the music and the man, quite possibly the greatest entertainer of all time. He would have been 51 years old in just 2 months, and he was on stage during every one of those 5 decades. Fans from the 80s called him our generation's Elvis. Beyoncé said he made a bigger impact on music than any other artist in history. So how did the music begin? How did the child of a steel worker in Gary, Indiana, go on to change musical history forever?
It's 1968. Michael Jackson and his 4 older brothers, powered by their father's ambition, are playing in Gary, Indiana. But they are dreaming of Detroit, home of Motown Records, founded by Berry Gordy, the hitmaker behind the great soul acts of the Stees. Berry's assistant, Suzanne DePass, sees the Jacksons perform.
My gosh, that's pretty special. Because this little tiny boy was singing with all the soul and passion of a 35-year-old man. I called Berry Gordy and I said, Mr. Gordy, I have seen something that is just great. He said, really, what is it? I said, it's an act. It's a fabulous singing group. He said, great. I said, they range in age from like 8 to 15. He said, kids?
So when she mentioned about another kids group, I just said, hey, I'm not really interested in another kids group. Not at this time.
I persisted and he said, well, gosh, if you feel that strongly about it, I'll take a look. And he did.
They came to Motown. This is a film of the audition.
When I first saw them, there was no question that I was interested, not only interested, but I loved them all. You know, I mean, it's incredible. I mean, it didn't take a genius to realize that they had, you know, the talent, and Michael was extremely special.
Gordy assigned Suzanne DePass to groom the boys, pick their clothing, choreograph dance steps, and make them rehearse and rehearse, while Gordy started looking for the song, the big hit.
And I thought about Michael and this little kid, and I wanted a song that would fit a 9-year-old kid, you know. And so I walked around singing a melody that just came into my head while thinking about this phenomenal kid. Oh, baby. No, I would say, oh, baby, da-da-dee-da-dee, da-da-da-da. That's all I had.
Oh, baby, give me one more chance.
Tell you that I love you.
Won't you please let me back in your heart?
Was the first release, and that went straight to number one. It was just a major smash.
I was probably in fourth grade, and I just remember walking home from school and just hearing that song coming out of car radios and little transistor. We had little transistor radios. I mean, it wasn't like Walkmans or boom boxes or anything, little tiny transistor radios, AM radio. And I just remember that song just It was the bomb. It was the bomb song.
Down, girl! I think I love! Go! Get up, girl! Show me what you can do!
In one quick succession, three more number one hits exploded on the airwaves.
Absolutely went from complete anonymity to total celebrity in one beat. The first time we got off the plane in Philadelphia for their first concert, they got mobbed, and it never changed. That was pretty profound for those days because there had not yet been, I don't think, a young black group that had created what was tantamount to Beatlemania.
When I had you, I treated you bad and wrong, my dear.
A black group shattering mainstream barriers and a little boy, the obsessive force driving it all.
His brothers might be outside, you know, playing basketball, but he'd be watching the producers mix the record or asking Berry Gordy 1,001 questions about producing and about the business and about why this, why that.
And then I realized that he was studying me. Later I realized, of course, he's not only studied me, but he studied everybody. From Walt Disney, Marcel Marceau, James Brown, Jackie Wilson, you know, all these people he was really studying.
We used to call him the human sponge.
It was inevitable. After 4 years of hits together, traveling together, performing together, Michael Jackson would shoot ahead of his brothers like a meteor.
When we first started, it was all for one, one for all. And I think as the press and the fans recognized Michael more and more, and it became a disproportionate kind of worship for him, you know, and interest in him, and obsession with the little one, that it drove a wedge between and among his brothers and himself and his brothers' relationships to one another.
So what would that wedge do to the five brothers? When we come back, how one of the five became the one and only and reinvented pop music. We're looking at a live shot of the boyhood home of Michael Jackson in Gary, Indiana, about 2 hours outside Chicago. It has been turned into a shrine tonight by fans who want to pay their respects. And Michael Jackson once said, "The thing I like most about being on stage is making people happy because I'm here for a reason. That's my job. I've been doing it for so long," he said. "As long as people enjoy it, I'll also be happy." Happy is what he made millions of us as his music continued to evolve and push the very limits of what a voice could do and entertainment could mean.
By the early 1980s, the Jackson 5 began to fade. Michael's solo career took off. Stop Till You Get Enough was the first single from the album Off the Wall, produced by legendary composer and arranger Quincy Jones.
When I first did the album, there were a lot of people, even at his own record company, that were saying he was making a big mistake, you know.
Off the the Wall sold 7 million copies. The blockbuster era had begun. Thriller would be the biggest selling album of all time and confirm the music video as a potent form of art and commerce.
Thriller was a phenomenon. I have a theory that you can't create a phenomenon. You can plan to do some television appearances, you can plan to do some videos. What you can't plan is the impact that each of those things are going to have. You can just do them the best you can. You do your album, let's say, now you put out the Billie Jean video. But it becomes more than a video, it becomes the video that breaks black music on MTV, because MTV wouldn't play a black video until Billie Jean. You can't create that. That's just the circumstances that happen. You can't create the Motown 25.
Million people watched a man whose every muscle moved in choreographed precision, not knowing it almost didn't happen.
Michael basically didn't want to do Motown 25, and I figured if it was ever going to happen, Barry would have to get in there and help.
One of the things I told him was that he thinks he's big now. I say, you are very big now. You think you're really big, but if you do Motown 25, you will go into orbit. That was the first show that he did the moonwalk on. And indeed, he went into orbit. I mean, he went into orbit and never came down.
Thriller sold 47 million records, and for an obsessive performer, a perfect trap. How to keep up this singular brand of mystery. How to top himself. In 1987, the album, Bad. He would release three more records, Dangerous, History, and Invincible. At the time of his death, Michael Jackson was the third highest selling recording artist of all time. But beyond the 750 million records sold and the thousands of sold out concerts, Michael Jackson's most enduring legacy is seen in the careers of the musical superstars who credit him as their inspiration. That story when we return.
For once in my life.
Moonwalk, flashy costumes, out of this world stage shows. It was all part of the Michael Jackson package, but his genius didn't end there. His performance style also became the template that shaped a whole new generation of musical artists. Justin Timberlake, Britney Spears, Beyonce, they all followed in his path and never forgot their teacher. Here's Chris Conley.
He would always acknowledge on his own musical career the influence of greats like Jackie Wilson and James Brown, whose sound and showmanship he sought to capture from his earliest days. And in turn, Michael Jackson inspired a generation of younger artists with his music, his style, and those astonishing videos. Who's that? Just ask this season's American Idol mainstays, Chris Allen and Adam Lambert, who themselves were barely toddlers during Michael's mid-80s heyday.
I grew up watching Michael Jackson, and I know Chris did too, huge influence.
I've loved music since I was a kid, and I think that he was kind of the first music that I fell in love with.
In time, his musical influence loomed large in each of their lives.
The first album that I had was the Dangerous album. I had all of his stuff, and I pretty much knew like almost every Michael Jackson song. I mean, it's weird, but you know what? My parents actually, they loved that I was really into his music.
Musically, he's, you know, he sounds like nobody else. His voice is so distinct. And then, you know, he wore, you know, really imaginative costumes and created imagery that nobody else was creating.
They're not alone in their admiration.
My mom grew up with Michael Jackson. I grew up with Michael Jackson. My little nieces and nephew grew up with Michael Jackson. So it's not just my generation, our generation.
They're not alone. Michael's singular artistry and multiple talents touched performers across many genres, from the soaringly emotional stylings of Mariah Carey, who covered the Jackson 5's I'll Be There, to the writing, producing, performing skills of Justin Timberlake, who called Michael an inspiration, as has now troubled teen vocalist Chris Brown.
Me personally, I've been a fan of his since I was younger, so me being able to listen to him and, you know what I'm saying, actually be inspired by his dancing as well as his music, like, actually drives me to be more creative.
Both got props from the King of Pop last year in a phone interview that commemorated his 50th birthday.
Who do you see out there now who reminds you the most of you?
Some of the younger, newer artists, like I think Chris Brown's doing wonderful, and Timberlake, and I really admire what they're doing.
Among his many other accolades, Michael Jackson would be called the Jackie Robinson of MTV, the man whose video for Billie Jean opened the door for so many other African-American performers to get big-time airtime on the channel.
Michael Jackson helped invent the idea of music as a very visual medium, you know, creating these videos that were as important as the music that he was making.
It was the sheer breadth of Michael's abilities that reconfigured a fractured pop music landscape back in the 80s. And he did it with a masterstroke, getting guitar wizard Eddie Van Halen to play on Beat It. And then he did it again, getting Guns N' Roses guitar man Slash to join him at the 1995 MTV VMAs. By then, even his musical collaborators, like producer Quincy Jones, knew he had smashed through every conceivable demographic barrier, as he told Charlie Gibson earlier today.
He, I think, was one of the first artists that transcended everything. It reminds me of Rollins with Harry Potter. You know, these things are hitting some nerve in young people that, you know, very few people ever attempt to do.
Those big-budget videos that launched the careers and set the personas of artists from Madonna to Diddy to Britney, Michael made all that possible by dropping $500,000 on Thriller. And in doing so, he also set a few fashion trends for some future superstars, as these voices from the 25th anniversary release of Thriller attest. They told
him, don't you ever come around. The red jacket and Beat It. I don't think you could walk down the street and see like a kid that didn't have that jacket. I mean, I had a leather red jacket.
I had one of the jackets. Everyone had the jacket.
Whether it's pleather or real leather, you had a beaded jacket.
He kind of defied sexuality and race in many ways. You know, he kind of like didn't go one way or another. He kind of stayed in the center of all of it, which I found it very, very intriguing and kind of appealing to everybody.
For Adam Lambert and Chris Allen, Michael's is a musical influence whose achievements they will always look to in admiration and amazement.
I feel like Michael Jackson has changed music completely when he started and everything that he did. And I think that it's evident in almost everything that everyone does.
Michael was a genius at inventing himself, inventing music, inventing imagery. He will be remembered for inspiring countless other artists. He will always be loved and adored on the radio, on the CD, and on vinyl, wherever you have him.
And when we come back, we move from the music to the moves. Michael Jackson as the master who taught millions how to dance. Stay with us. You are looking at a live shot of the Hollywood Walk of Fame on Hollywood Boulevard in Los Angeles. Thousands of fans have been waiting in line patiently for their chance to file past Michael Jackson's star. They have been waiting all day long, fans, to get their chance to pay their respects. Not only was Michael Jackson an incredible musician, he was a magician of dance. His incredible moves now live forever in dance videos that reinvented the genre. And that's what a generation of younger artists grew up watching and imitating. Here's Deborah Roberts.
Where did it come from? The steps, unlike anything ever witnessed.
There's an expression about trying to capture lightning in a bottle. Whenever you saw Michael Jackson on stage, that's what it was like. It was like that thunderstorm that came out, lightning and thunder and power, and then it would all calm down, and then you could see better. And then he was smooth and quiet like the gentle rain. He was all of that. He was a force of nature, and to see him on the stage was like an experience I cannot describe. If you didn't ever see him, then you missed it.
Choreographer to the stars, Debbie Allen, has seen them all, but no one like her longtime friend, Michael.
In dance, it's what we sit and train for, we try to teach. You either have this or you don't. Michael danced with such a sharpness. He was so clean, he was so, his precision was beyond. And this is a true master. Michael practiced, Michael trained. Michael continued to try to expand his dance vocabulary. That was our relationship. He was always coming up to my house and wanted me to teach him something that he might not know. I'm like, child, you know everything, stop it. Talking about he wanted to turn like Baryshnikov. I said, child, you turn better than Baryshnikov, leave me alone.
Director Kenny Ortega was working with Michael on his comeback tour.
When Michael got into the zone, it was Michael, as we all have known him and have all fallen in love with, you know, that incredible entertainer, the perfect timing and know-how, and just, you know, sparking, you know, electric, electricity flying off of him, inspiring everyone around him, the dancers, the singers, the orchestra, and every creative person, you know, involved in the project.
Show me what you do. Teach me.
In the documentary Living with Michael Jackson, he told Martin Bashir it's hard to pinpoint where it all began.
Did somebody teach you to do that?
No, you can't teach that. You can't teach it. It has to come from inside. It's a gift, you know.
At this Grammy Award ceremony, Jackson admitted he did have his influences.
I remember when we were little, I used to ask her to be Ginger Rogers while I was Fred Astaire.
But he took it somewhere all his own. Martin Scorsese directed the video Bad and says watching Jackson was like watching Quicksilver in motion.
What was it about him as a dancer? What was that thing?
Each time just going in, and he really went in. And as a dancer, as a good one, you want to go in and focus your energy, and he could actually really focus on a dime. Who's
bad? That's Desmond Richardson to the right with Michael in that video. He says Jackson revolutionized the world of dance.
It just opened our eyes, like, wow, we don't have to stay compartmentalized in this, you know, I'm only doing ballet, or I'm only doing jazz, or I'm only, you know, popping, or it can be all together.
And And nowhere was it more apparent than in that trademark moonwalk. It took the country by storm. Jackson first debuted on the Motown 25th anniversary special back in 1983.
I just remember phones ringing immediately after he did that, you know, trying to get to the phone. Did you just say what happened? You know, because I had never seen anything like that. You could feel the roar of the audience, and I know in my own living room, you know, my roommate and I just screamed, you know, and you just want to play it again and again and again. And I mean, that's the kind of transcendent figure he was, you know, to create this kind of excitement.
And from that moment on, he became a teacher to dancers everywhere, from Paula Abdul.
What did you learn from him? Anything?
Oh my gosh. You never let anyone see you sweat. And when you perform, you give everything that you have, every pore of your body, everything that spills out is left on that stage. And the commitment, and it's the rehearsal. The drive that guy had was unparalleled. I've never seen anyone work that hard.
And from that moment on, he became a teacher to dancers everywhere, from Paula Abdul to pop stars all over, like Justin Timberlake, Usher, and Ne-Yo.
Sort of embrace the inspiration of Michael and take it to a whole nother level. So we're not just looking at dance steps and some good tunes, we're looking at a whole show, and that's what Michael was all about, bringing everything together and making that show pop. And you're just like mesmerized when you're watching a concert.
What does today feel like for you?
It hurts. You know, you just, like that song, never can say goodbye. You know, we just can't say goodbye to him. So I'm just gonna put it, you know, we're gonna all be living with this big hole in our hearts. That's how it's gonna be.
So many people tonight saying goodbye. And when we come back, the very latest on the investigation into the death of Michael Jackson. Stay with us. Looking at a live shot tonight at the Apollo Theater in Harlem, where Michael Jackson performed with his brothers as a boy. And it's an impromptu celebration of his life by fans who have gathered outside, many of them dressed up in Michael Jackson costumes, dancing to his music. And even tonight, as we salute the man and his music, real questions remain about what killed Michael Jackson. For the very latest on the investigation, starting with the 911 call that signaled the beginning of the end, here is Jim Avila.
What is your emergency?
Yes, sir. I need an ambulance as soon as possible, sir.
12:21 West Coast time, and the caller at Carrollwood Drive in Los Angeles is in a panic.
We have a gentleman here that needs help, and he's not breathing yet. He's not breathing, and we're trying to pump him, but he's not
okay.
Breathing, sir.
Okay, how old is he?
He's 50 years old, sir.
50, okay. He's unconscious, he's not breathing?
Yes, he's not breathing, sir.
Okay, and he's not conscious either?
He's not conscious, sir.
Okay.
And while the caller is careful not to reveal who is in trouble, it is not just any 50-year-old who's lying unconscious. This is the King of Pop, lifeless and unresponsive, even though he's getting professional medical help.
Okay, let's get him down to the floor. I'm going to help you with CPR right now, okay?
We need him. We need
yes, we're already on our way there. We're on our way. I'm going to do as
Thank
much
you,
I can
sir.
To help you over the phone. We're already on our way. Did anybody see him?
Yes, we have a personal doctor here with him, sir.
Oh, you have a doctor there?
Yes, but he's not responding to anything. No, he's not responding to CPR or anything, sir.
Oh, okay. Well, we're on our way there. If your guys are doing CPR and you're instructed by a doctor, he has a higher authority than me. And he's
Thank
there
you.
On scene.
Okay.
Did anybody witness what happened?
No, just the doctor, sir. The doctor's been the only one here.
Okay, so did the doctor see what happened?
Doctor, did you see what happened, sir? Sir, you just If you can please.
We're on our way.
But that doctor, the one in such a hurry to get paramedics on scene, the one who saw what happened to Michael Jackson but would not stop and explain, his name is Murray Conrad Robert, and he has long since disappeared, apparently in a hurry, leaving his car behind. It was towed from the estate, and the Los Angeles Police Department now has an appointment to interview him. Perhaps because, as LAPD sources tell ABC News, Jackson was heavily addicted to the powerful and dangerous painkiller OxyContin, receiving daily doses of it and another synthetic opiate painkiller called Demerol. In a press conference just a few hours ago, Craig Harvey of the Los Angeles Coroner's Office told reporters they know Jackson had drugs in his body.
Well, we know he was taking some prescription medications. The cause of death has been deferred, which means that the medical examiner has ordered additional testing, such as toxicology and other studies. Those tests, we anticipate, will take approximately 4 to 6 additional weeks to complete.
That comes as no surprise to former Jackson attorney Brian Oxman, who told Good Morning America.
Well, if you will remember back to the Pepsi commercial that Michael was filming at the Shrine Auditorium, his hair caught on fire, and it caused him such pain. He just didn't like to feel such discomfort. He started taking pain medications then. He fell off a stage, and he cracked a vertebrae in his back. He also broke his leg. Those two things were constant sources of pain. They made him fall down. They were so painful. He took the medications because of that pain.
According to Dr. Bruce Goldberger, a forensic toxicologist in Gainesville, Florida, Jackson's apparent mix of drugs was a lethal combination.
Someone who's being treated for pain, for example, as it's been reported with Michael Jackson, these patients are also anxious. These people also have depression. So it's often necessary to prescribe an analgesic medication like OxyContin to relieve the pain. Second, they'll prescribe an antidepressant to relieve the depression. And third, they may prescribe a sedative drug like Xanax to relieve the anxiety. It's when it leads to the misuse or abuse of these drugs and then ultimate toxicity.
Police sources tell ABC News Jackson was injected with drugs an hour before his death. And Dr. Goldberger says if that's the case, there is only a narrow window for revival.
These drugs, while they affect pain on the body, they can also produce depression of our central nervous system. So what we see is someone becomes very lethargic and fatigued. We see a slowing of the respiratory rate and the heart rate and a loss of blood pressure. So in the end, there's a collapse of the individual leading to a cardiac arrest and then death.
Jackson had long been suspected as a heavy user. In 2007, one pharmacy sued him for $100,000 he allegedly owed for prescription drugs. And in yet another sign today, in her blog, Jackson's former wife, Lisa Marie Presley, talked of her fear of his self-destructive behavior and says Michael Jackson was afraid of dying the same way her father Elvis did. Quote, "I'm afraid that I'm going to end up like him, the way he did." Michael Jackson himself wrote about Demerol in a 1997 album called Blood on the Dance Floor. So how did the 50-year-old singer expect to make it through an exhausting 50-date concert tour? This is the audition for the dancers. It was going to be a typical, athletic, physical Jackson performance. And some of the people who watched rehearsals say Michael was not himself.
Michael always looked frail to me. That said, It's the root of his character. He's a sweet, gentle soul, compassionate, considerate, loving, and he has this little frail demeanor.
Johnny Caswell runs the Center Staging Complex in Southern California, where Michael Jackson went through the paces.
I think the intent was to create the biggest, best, most spectacular production that has ever been done before. Something that would dwarf any previous productions that were out on the road or on a production stage. That was the goal, and that was the intent of the producers. And Kenny Ortega at the helm.
Choreographer Kenny Ortega was working with Michael Jackson, getting him ready for the tour.
Last couple of nights of rehearsal, we all stood there in awe and realized that we were all headed for a new moment in history where we were going to recognize the greatest triumph, you know, and comeback in rock and roll history. And it was with great weight, sorrow, and sadness that that we lost him.
It was to be a celebration of Michael Jackson at 50. 50 concert nights that would have made Jackson $50 million. A tour that ended before it began, and a life that ended not in celebration, but in grief.
And Jim Avila joins us now. Getting back to that three-hour autopsy today, I know we're waiting for toxicology tests in 4 to 6 weeks, but can we tell anything from today's autopsy?
Well, only limited information was released today, Elizabeth, and the hardest facts released were that there was no signs of any kind of foul play. No trauma to the body. So that has been ruled
and no,
ruled out.
No sign of a pre-existing heart disease?
They didn't talk about that at this point. They're waiting for tests on that. They didn't talk about the condition of his heart. They didn't talk about what kind of drugs may be found in the body. They do say they know that he was taking prescription drugs. They didn't say whether or not he was abusing prescription drugs.
And what about this doctor, this personal physician that we hear about on the 911 tape administering CPR, who was with Michael Jackson, and the person on the 911 tape is saying, "Doctor, what happened? Why did it take authorities all this time to finally track him down and still just on the telephone to make an appointment?"
Well, certainly that's the big mystery. And in fact, the Los Angeles Police Department said today three things: that they had contacted this doctor by phone, that they had to contact other police agencies around the country to locate the doctor, and that they have now found him and expect to talk to him and have made an appointment, and that he is cooperating. They expect his cooperation at this point. But certainly his demeanor right after Michael Jackson was taken to the hospital is at least needs to be questioned, because as we see, his car was left there and he was gone.
Questionable at the very least. All right, Jim Avila, thanks so much for that report. And when we come back, more of our musical journey, how the King of Pop taught Diane Sawyer how to become a human beatbox. Stay with us. Don't you know?
Time and temperature from TD Bank.
Well, since yesterday, the soundtrack of the world has been Michael Jackson. On radios, iPods, CD players, we've all been listening to our personal favorites. In 1995, Michael Jackson showed Diane Sawyer just how he did what he did. The hours he spent alone in rehearsal halls to bring us the music and the moves. Other artists find inspiration in collaboration, but Michael Jackson liked to sweat it out alone.
But somehow Jackson used the isolation to sharpen his sense of what was exotic and new. By 1983, the 25th anniversary of Motown, another Michael Jackson emerged, his own creation, from the muscle to the music and the magic.
Is that as good as it gets as a performer?
Gee, if I say no, I'll sound arrogant. I don't think I'm ever pleased with my performances. Never. And after that performance, I wasn't happy either. I wanted to do the five spins, then go on the toes and freeze there and just hold it and stay there, you know, and I didn't, but they didn't know.
Do you have to top yourself all the time, and is that the hardest part?
I think the next one is always the toughest one, because people expect more and more.
More from the music, and more surprises from the chameleon looks, which became more extreme. You wonder if this is still his plan, or like Faust, his prison. Even today, Jackson obsesses over every word, every move, every sound.
Hit it.
What you're hearing is not the electric drum machine. It's a hardwired 48-track digitally mastered human.
What I mean, so I'll take that and use that as the main foundation for the track and build all the sounds around that. You know what I'm saying?
So whatever the future, the music is still inside the man, who says soon he'll be back where he's most at home.
Are you really anxious to get back on stage?
I miss the fans.
Yeah.
That's my chance to get to really, you know, see them and feel their presence.
They follow each other on the wind, you know. Cause they got nowhere to go. That's why no one get to know. I'm standing with the man in the mirror.
When you do a concert and it's like 100,000 people out there and they're, and it's a song that you wrote in a little hotel room somewhere. And you see a sea of people singing the lyrics, all in unison, and holding up candles, and you go, wow. You know, it just really makes your heart happy. And that's what really makes you feel like everything's okay.
A 100,000 fans all holding up their candles and listening to Michael Jackson talk about his future. Those fans now, of course, holding up their candles in memory. And coming up in our next hour and after your local news on Nightline, we'll have more on Michael Jackson. But as we leave you now, take another look at the legendary Michael Jackson.
That's what I really mean when, like, I'm singing a song. I don't sing it if I don't mean it.
Shiny and sparkly and splendidly bright. Here one day, gone one night. Gone too soon.